Just 2 days ago, the world celebrated the International Women's Day. And keeping in mind that this is also the month of Jamadi al-Thaniya, which is the month related to Bibi Fatima al-Zahra, salawatullah alayha. I would like to take this opportunity to talk about the Islamic perspective on women. It's a very vast topic. You know, I don't think the timing of Juma khutba would be sufficient for it, but at least here we can have a reminder as a brief statement about what is the Islamic perspective on women. Let me begin by saying that when it comes to humanity, when we talk about this issue of insaniyat, of a person, and the potential that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to the insan, to the human being, to attain higher levels of virtue and righteousness, Islam does not see any difference between men and women on that level. It's actually interesting, you know, sometimes it's important to know some of these historical changes which has come. You know, the world was not always the way it is now. If you study Christian theology just about in a century back, you will see that one of the discussions they used to have was about women and the black people, whether they have souls or not. So the men were assumed, you know, they have a soul. But when it came to women and the black people, the question was whether they have a soul or not. This was a theological discussion. And that is why you will see even the application of the word person was in the language, you know, till about 1930. Even in Canada, when the women started to demand the right to vote in elections. Remember, before 1930, they didn't have this right. Only men used to go and, you know, vote for the elections. When they demanded that, you know, that became an issue. And the question, you know, istifta, if I may use the term, was sent to the, you know, men seat of power those days, London, England. And there they said, yes, you know, the where it says that, you know, persons are allowed to cast vote, this also includes women. So even the language was not always, you know, inclusive in that way. But if you look at Islam, this was never. You study the history of Islamic theology, Shia or Sunni, doesn't matter. This was never an issue at all. This was not even a point of discussion. Because when we talk about insan, you know, it applies to both male as well as female. This was not an issue whether only male have nafs, ruh, and soul, and women don't have. Actually, if you look at it from the grammatical point of view, you know, the word nafs. For example, in Surah Shams, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where he says, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَا وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا طَلَاهَا, it says, by the sun and the moon and the day and the night and the heavens and the earth. And then he says, وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا. Then he says, the soul of the human being. You know, by the sun and the moon and the day and the night and the heavens and the earth and by, you know, this is qasam. And by the soul of the human being, you know, فَأَلْحَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. That he inspired to the nafs what is right and what is wrong. If you look at the Arabic wordings, فَأَلْهَمَهَا. Ha is used for feminine. The word nafs grammatically is a feminine you know, noun. So even the nafs of a man grammatically is female. It's a feminine. You know, so we in Islamic theology, we never had this discussion. It was taken for granted that in al-insan, whether male or female, are same on the level of insaniyat. And this is where we come to the issue of faza'il. You know, faza'il and the virtues and qualities which are to be found in a human being. the potential to acquire those faza'il, fazilat, is equal as far as, you know, male and female are concerned. For example, if you study the Qur'an, you will see that, you know, although most of the Qur'an uses masculine style of speech, and this is not only Qur'an, all languages, till very recently, you know, they were mostly, you know, the books would be written in a more masculine style of the language, whatever language it is. It is only now that, you know, you get this training how to write in a way that you are not really specifying a gender there. Gender neutral writing. This is a new thing. And so even Quran, which was revealed 1400 years ago, as far as the language is concerned, it's mostly in masculine form. Although no Muslim ever, a layman or a scholar, has ever said that the verses of the Quran, even though they are in masculine form, they only refer to men. No. For example, the command for prayers, aqimu salat, is a masculine, you know, prerogative there, which is, you know, amr. Amr in the form of masculine form. Although we have the ayat of Quran, which is in plural form also, aqimna salat. But even if that aqimna salat was not there, just aqimu salat by itself was sufficient to apply the ruling of namaz on men as well as women. But we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kind of goes out of his way in certain verses of the Quran. Whenever when he starts talking about the fada'il of insan, the virtues of human beings, in some places he actually repeats himself using the words in masculine and then feminine form again and again. You know, if you look at, for example, Surah Ahzab, which is surah number 33, ayat 35, this is where you will see, إِنَّ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْقَانِتَاتِ وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّابِرَاتِ وَالْخَاشِئِينَ وَالْخَاشِئَاتِ وَالْمُتَصَدِّقِينَ وَالْمُتَصَدِّقَاتِ وَالصَّائِمِينَ وَالصَّائِمَاتِ. In all these places, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is repeating the masculine and then the feminine form of the word there. He says, you know, when it comes to the issue of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to the issue of iman, al-mu'mineen wal-mu'minat, when it comes to the issue of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to the issue of being truthful, as-sadiqeen was-sadiqat, when it comes to the virtue of sabr and patience, as-sabireen was-sabirat, when we talk about the humility, you know, a person has to be humble in interaction with one another, al-khashi'een wal-khashi'at, wal-mutasaddiqeen wal-mutasaddiqat, when it comes to do charity, to be charitable towards those who are less fortunate in the society, was-sa'imeen was-sa'imat, and those who do the fasting, men and women, وَالْحَافِظِينَ فُرُوجَهُمْ وَالْحَافِظَاتِ, the men and the women who are chaste in their relationship, وَالذَّاكِرِينَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالذَّاكِرَاتِ, and those men who remember God quite a lot, and even the women who do that. In all these places, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is repeating the words. If you wrote that in English and gave it to your editor, he will say, you know, it's a very wordy sentence. Why are you repeating again and again and again? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here wants to emphasize the point that when it comes to the fadl, fada'il, fazilat of a human being, there is no difference between the potential of the male versus the female. Salawat. Let me end with one, you know, simple idea to think about. And this is from one of the prominent scholars of Islamic laws these days. Remember two words. One is fazl, fazilat, and the other is farz, duty. Whenever it comes to the fazl of an insan, you know, good qualities of a human being, Islam does not differentiate on gender lines. But when it comes to the issues of farz, duty, wherever you see the differences in family laws, you know, that has nothing to do with fazilat of insan. It has more to do with the issue of farz, duties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has assigned to different individuals, especially when it comes to husband-wife relationship in a family context. And so those are not an issue of saying one is superior and the other inferior. These are the fara'is, these are the duties that people have to, you know, fulfill in order to manage the society in the best form. You know, I once gave an example, and I don't shy away from repeating examples. You know, you might have a very high-end car, very expensive, and maybe you might be the mayor of the city. But when you drive, and if the traffic light is red, you will have to stop. But there will be another car passing on the other lane, maybe less expensive than yours, and maybe being an employee of the city, you are the boss and he is your worker, but he is an emergency personnel. With his lights on, even on the light is red, he will just go through. Will you say that's fazilat for him, or it is farz for him? Fazilat is there with the mayor, but he has to stop. You have to realize that, you know, this is where we see sometimes, you know, some people are allowed to do certain things, some are not. It doesn't mean that other guy is more, you know, superior. It is to do with the issue of farz, not fazilat. And this is where we have to understand Islam in its own context. The problem is there is a lot of misinformation, you know, going out, even among the Muslims, unfortunately, and they do not understand the wisdom which has come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to understand the message of Allah in the best possible manner. In أحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المظلمين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم keeping in mind the month of Bibi Fatima Zahra, you know, let me mention her example in the context of what I talked about fazl and farz, the difference. Fatima al-Zahra salawatullah alayha was was not a Nabi or Rasul or an Imam, because those are the positions of responsibility and duties. But when you talk about faza'il, the fadilah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given, this is where you see that she is on par with her father, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as well as her husband, Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. When it comes to the quality of infallibility, Allah has blessed us, her in the same way as the Prophet and the Imam. Rather, if you look at that entire story of Hadith Kisa, where this ayat of Tathir about the purity and infallibility of the Prophet and his family was revealed, under that Kisa, under that charter, you know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to the question of Jibreel, when he asked, who are these people on whom this ayat is going to be revealed? The way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Panjatan, Ahli Kisa, it starts with Fatima. Hum Fatimatu wa abuha wa ba'luha wa banuha. She was the central figure in that. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it's Fatima, her father, her husband, and the two sons. When you look at the title given to her, it is Sadiqa or Siddiqa, which means somebody who embodiment, you know, was embodiment of truth in all its dimensions, not only in speech, even in her character and her iman and her behavior. And this is where she basically was qualified to be part of this event known as Mubahala. This happened in the 9th year of the Hijrah. The Prophet was in the city of Medina. There were many, many people around that he could have taken with him. But when it came to women, he only selected one lady to be with him, and that was Fatima Zahra, salawatullah alayha. And not only that, she is Hujjatullah like the Aimmah. Her words are as binding for us as the words of Ali and Hassan and Hussein. You know, when it comes to her status, she is like Amir al-Mu'mineen. Ali was the Wali of Allah, and she is Waliyutullah. And this is where we see that, you know, when you look at the history of Islam, especially from the Shi'i point of view, you know, women indeed have played a very important role. You know, when you look at this ayat from Surah Tawbah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the duty of the believers on a societal and communal level, he begins by saying, إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ يَعْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْحَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. That believing men and women both are supporters of one another, they are wali of one another. And what do? They promote good in society and stand up against evil in society. Amr bil ma'ruf wa nahy al munkar. And for us, the example of Fatima Zahra is an example of somebody who stood up to protest against the violation of the law of inheritance in her case. She was the first victim of what I would call, you know, trying to diminish the rights that Islam has given to women as far as the issue of inheritance is concerned. And she stands up and very clearly and eloquently brings up the ayat of Quran against the Khalifa of the time, that how can you deny me my right? Well, you know, these are the ayat of Quran which is clear on this issue. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, we don't need to look here and there. As far as role models are concerned, for us, Muhammad and Ali Muhammad are sufficient role models. Finally, we have to try our best to follow her example, because one of the honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to her, just like her father and her husband, she also has the right of shafa'at, to intercede on our behalf on the day of Qiyamah. And that is why she is included in what is known as Dua Tawassul that we have, where we invoke her name also when we have our own hajat and we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma salli ala Sayyid al-Mursaleen wa Shafi al-Mudhunibin Nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. وعلى إمام المتقين وأمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه. وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان ما حي أثار البدو والطغيان هادم أبنية الشرك والنفاق حاصد فرو البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتسلت الليالي والأيام اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون